privacy, let the data where it is. So we run all the requests remotely. We, to preserve the user experience, we build a synthetic copy of the data so that the analyst can build code on something. And most important, we give differential privacy guarantees on everything that gets to the analyst. Why did we contribute to OpenDP? The main reason is that we have many kinds of mechanism, like Gaussian mechanism, exponential mechanism, or other kinds of mechanism, even custom ones like toss thresholding for SQL queries. And we have various concepts of composition and accounting, like Bayesian composition, Reni. And some of them are adapted to some mechanism, but not all of them. So the situation is really not ideal today. But recently, a new concept of differential privacy, the F differential privacy, has been developed. And it gives homogeneous and universal framework to deal with all kinds of mechanisms. And that's really the core of our contribution to OpenDP.
Hello, everyone. I'm Victoria de Saint-Agathe. I am a research engineer at Sarus. And I'm going to present you our work about implementing FDP guarantees in OpenDP. So first, I will go through the theory behind it, and then I will explain how did we implement it in OpenDP. So we want a user to be able to analyze some sensitive data, but we don't want him to learn whether or not an individual, let's say Alice, is in this data set. So this can be reformulated as a hypothesis testing, where the null hypothesis is Alice is not in the data set, while the alternative hypothesis is Alice is in the data set. And from the point of view of an adversary, you want to minimize your error. So the type one error is a false detection of Alice in the data set. And the type two error is a missed detection of Alice. So in the case where you know nothing about the data set, you may randomly guess whether or not Alice is in the data set. And for example, you may always say she's not in the data set. And in that case, you are making only type two errors. On the other hand, if you always say she is in the data set, you are making only type one errors. So you may randomly guess whether Alice is or not in the data set. And when the probability varies, you have this indistinguishability line. So now, if you know something about the data set, your error may decrease. And the lower bound of the achievable errors is called the trade-off function. And this exactly characterizes the privacy loss of a mechanism. So traditionally, in differential privacy, we characterize the privacy loss of a mechanism with the epsilon and delta parameters. And these can be converted into a trade-off function here in green, where the slope of the trade-off function is given by the epsilon parameter, and the coordinate at the origin is given by the delta parameter. And the farther from the indistinguishability line, the less private the mechanism. So now, F-differential privacy is about exactly characterizing the privacy loss with not just two parameters, but with the trade-off function. And this is equivalent to characterize the mechanism with a family of epsilon delta. And this family may be finite or infinite. So this is the case of a Laplace mechanism. The exact trade-off function is represented here in red. And I have also plotted two of the epsilon delta trade-off functions. And we see that these epsilon delta trade-off function are the tangent line of the exact Laplace trade-off function. So they are always smaller than the exact trade-off function. In F differential privacy, there is an exact formula for the composition, but in practice, we do not use it, and we prefer to work only with reduced mechanism. So we reduce each mechanism to a finite family of epsilon delta, and then we will use an approximation for the composition. So we will see an example on the Gaussian mechanism. So a Gaussian mechanism has a trade-off function which is equivalent to an infinite numbers of epsilon delta trade-off functions. So the exact trade-off function is here in red, and we want to have a lower approximation. So we don't want to overestimate the privacy, the trade-off function. We always want to underestimate it, because if we don't, we may underestimate the privacy parameters, and in a real case, we don't want to do that. So the exact trade-off function may be approximated by the intersection of a subset of the epsilon delta trade-off functions. So these are the one you see here in green, and the more the larger the number of epsilon deltas, the closer the approximation from the exact trade-off function. We also have to make sure that the roundings, if you are using floats, you have to control all the roundings, because if you do not, you may sometimes overestimate the trade-off function. So one way out is to use only rational numbers, and by doing that, you are sure that you are doing exact computations on these rational numbers. So now, once we have reduced each mechanism to a finite numbers of epsilon delta pairs, we can compose them. And if you do, you obtain the point here in red, and the number of epsilon delta pairs increases exponentially with the number of compositions. So you have to reduce the composition, you have to reduce the mechanism at the end of each composition and to select only a subset of the epsilon delta pairs. Besides, since we are using rational numbers, the numerator and denominator of the rational numbers may become very large. So we have to limit them. And when we do that, we have to make sure that we have an underestimation of the trade-off function. Okay, so we have implemented this method in OpenDP, we want to use it as an accountant in our product. So we need this accountant to be able to handle very various mechanisms, such as Laplace, Gaussian mechanism, toe thresholding, etc. And we want this accountant to give tight bounds on the privacy perception, because the only universal accountant for the moment is basic composition theorem or advanced composition theorem, but they give largely overestimate the privacy perception. So this means that a user which has a privacy budget spent will not be able to ask for all the queries it should have been allowed to. So let's see an example. So in the case where the user has queries which involve only Laplace mechanisms, from the data owner point of view, you want to limit the type 2 error. So the user will be able to ask for a query as long as its type 2 error is larger than this threshold. So in the case where the accountant implements a basic composition, is implemented with basic composition theorem, the user may be able to ask for just 4 queries, while if the accountant is implemented with approx FDP, he will be able to ask for many more queries. So, so now about our implementation in OpenDP. So first, before this project, I've never used Rust. So this was a good occasion of learning coding in Rust. I was very interested by this type, its type system. So at the beginning, it's maybe very annoying to define the type of each variable and you cannot mix some types with another, and there is no because there is no implicit conversion in Rust. So this can be annoying at the beginning, but prevents many mistakes. And in our case, we only wanted to use rational numbers. So this was ensured by a Rust type system. Besides, there is this rug library in Rust, which provides rational and float objects, which were very useful for us. And also, I have learned about this tray and generic objects in Rust, which allows to have a very generic implementation in our code. And I think this makes OpenDP very flexible, because in OpenDP there is a lot of very formal definition of differential privacy and very generic, and they allow to put anything we want in it. And we will see an example on the privacy relation. So when you are defining a measurement, which is a mechanism in OpenDP, you have to define a corresponding privacy relation. And this privacy relation is a method which input a distance between data sets. This can be the distance you want. And it inputs also some privacy parameters. In this case, it's epsilon deltas, but in our case, it was a vector of epsilon deltas. And this may have been a method like the trader function. And this privacy relation returns true if the corresponding mechanism is differentially private for the definition you have implemented in it. So it can be epsilon delta differential privacy, it can be F differential privacy, it can be Reni differential privacy. I think it can be anything you want. And it's true for this definition of differential privacy and the input parameters. So this is very generic, but this is not very efficient for the composition, because for the composition, you need to have access to the privacy parameters. So one way out is to, so the only solution here is to do a binary search at each composition, but it's maybe very inefficient for when you have hundreds of mechanisms. So one way out is to use hints and pair each mechanism with a corresponding hint. And a hint is the method. And in our case, it's a method which inputs an epsilon and returns the corresponding delta. So we have two implementations. In the first one, the hint is implemented in one part and the mechanism in another part. So when you want to use the mechanism with the hints, you have to define both of them and input both of them in the method which does the composition. In the second option, which is more user-friendly, I think, the hint is defined in the measurement itself. So we will see some example. So for the first option, you have to define the measurement. So this is a Laplace mechanism with a scale of 1. And you define the corresponding hints here. Same thing for the second mechanism. Then you do the composition. So the composition is done by a method which inputs the two measurements and the two hints. And this returns a measurement and a hint. So this option, I think it's more in accordance with the current OpenDP framework. But I think that the second method is better for the user because the user may define only the Laplace, has only to define the mechanism, the first mechanism, the second mechanism, and then for the composition, he does the composition and he doesn't need to know about the hints. Since they are implemented inside the measurements. So to conclude, this was a really good experience to contribute to OpenDP because we had this idea about implementing an accountant using an approximation of a differential privacy. And then during this project, we had the occasion to discuss about that and about the implementation and the theory about all the OpenDP team. And this was really fruitful, and I thank you all for that. And also, so we are planning to use this accountant very soon in our product. Besides, we are already using OpenDP through Smart Noise for our DP SQL engine. And so contributing to OpenDP was a good occasion to discover more about OpenDP. And we were very interested by this new framework, which allows to implement many new features. And once the library will be more mature, we are planning to use it more in our product. So thank you for your attention. And if you have any questions, please ask.
We can either ask questions now, maybe one or two, or leave them to the end or put them in the chat. So before we started, we didn't get to introduce Victoria in the question. Let me just highlight them, spotlight. So Victoria is a research engineer at the Soros Technologies in France. And same as question, they're both fellows. With OpenDP and then spent a good 10 weeks with us and then still with us. We're very happy with that. And Christian is the basic algorithms research, Copenhagen. Christian, you're PhD student, right?
Yes.
Yeah. And then in the IT University of Copenhagen. So Christian, you're next.
Yes, let me try to share my screen. I think. I think I can take. Okay, you should be able to see my screen now.
Yeah, works great.
I see some nodding. Great. Yes. So my name is Christian, and I would like to present my project during the OpenDP Fellow Project on an implementation for representing differentially private sparse histograms. So first, I would like to give a short overview of my presentation. I'll start out by discussing my background and motivation a bit to put this presentation into some context. Then I'll briefly discuss the purpose of my contribution, but I will not discuss any technical details in this presentation. I will focus more on the next point, which is sort of an overview of the project and how projects or similar projects can be for other potential contributors, and then discuss my own personal experience during the fellow program. And I'll finish off with some reflections and open up for any potential questions. First off, I'm from Denmark. I studied at the IT University. I have a bachelor in software development and a master in computer science. And since last year, I started my PhD study a year ago. I'm at this research center called Basic Algorithms Research Copenhagen, and I'm at the IT University, as Annie said. My research area is differentially private algorithms and data structures, both from dealing with theory and, in the case of OpenDP here, more practical applications. And of course, I was part of the fellow program during this summer, which is why I'm here. Now, my motivation for applying for the OpenDP project, there are several factors that motivated me to do so. Of course, it was related to my PhD project, specifically in collaboration with my two advisors. We have come up with a new differential private data structure for handling sparse data. And this was a great opportunity to go from pure theory or maybe having a prototype implementation to actually creating a full implementation that people can use without being experts in differential privacy. So this sort of goes back to the purpose of OpenDP, that this is also what we want here to have an actual implementation of our work. And in general, I'm a big proponent of open source software. So this was also part of my motivation, that I align with a lot of values of OpenDP. The fellow program also allowed me to become part of this large international community. This has especially been great since I have only been, my entire PhD study so far has been during this global pandemic. What is my contribution? It is a data structure for answering point queries in sparse histograms. So if we have a sparse histogram, would be the most of the entries contain a zero, and then we want our algorithm to make sure that we don't explicitly have to store all these bin. I have a small example here, mostly a toy example here on the right. If we ask a bunch of people what their favorite website are, then there are more than a billion possible answers because there are so many websites, but there will be a large representation in a few popular websites, and the vast majority of websites will not be mentioned by anyone, even if we ask a lot of people. But we still want to be able to have a differential private data structure to work with this. And this is my contribution. And with a simple post-processing step, you can still ask these questions of, for how many people preferred Google or YouTube or OpenDP.org or whatever website you're interested in. And as I said, I won't provide any technical details about how this works, but I will more focus on the process itself and how I experienced this fellow's program. So this slide has an overview of the project. So the main goal was, of course, to add an implementation of a work to the OpenDP core library. And what this means concretely is implementing a measurement to the Rust library. That's the main goal. And then I identified some of the steps that one might go through when contributing to the library. And I'll go through a bit more in detail in the coming slides, but briefly, what you want to do is first you, of course, need to get some overview of how the library works. And this is also what has been talked about today already. Then you want to identify what domains you are using and more. I'll get back to that one. Then the main step is, of course, to actually implement this measurement in the Rust library. As this is the core of the contribution. After that is done, you can, it could be extended with the FFI layers and the bindings, which was discussed in the previous session. And then also you would of course need to write this privacy proof that was also briefly discussed and add some example to the documentation so the end users can make great use of the contribution in the end. So now I will talk a bit about my experience in each of these steps. First one is getting an understanding of how the OpenDP library works. Some of the resources I found useful in this process is talks like the one that Mike and Andrew just gave. In the last session, in my case, it was part of the fellow program, but here I wrote the example of the community meeting. This is a great way to get some understanding of the library. I can also recommend reading the white paper on the OpenDP programming framework, which can be very helpful to get an understanding about how the framework works before actually interacting with the source code. And then at the OpenDP docs, there are some useful tools for setting up the library, figuring out how to interact with the implementation. And finally, looking at the actual source code is useful. In my case, I was implementing a measurement. So for me, it was very useful to see how some of the other measurements are implemented, because a lot of the actual implementation overlaps in some way. Let me just go to the next slide. This slide, I won't spend too much time on this, but the next step before implementing the algorithm is to identify the domains, metric, and measurements needed. This is sort of to make sure that your contribution fits well into the library, and also you figure out what is the scope of the actual implementation or the contribution. So what is the exact input and output that you will be supporting? I have some code here that I've used that it's useful to define these types to fit well into the library. But let me go to the next slide. Yeah, the main work is, of course, implementing the measurement itself. Some of the challenges here are basic software development challenges. You have to make sure your code works as intended. And yeah, not much specific to the library to say here. Instead, I will focus on a few of the design decisions that were interesting from my perspective when I was implementing my contribution. So this can be this might relate to some other project, but of course not everyone. It will depend a lot on the concrete algorithm. But for me, I also had some issues with how I should handle floating points. And for my specific purpose, the best solution was to centralize the part of the mechanism that was very dependent on these floating point arithmetics in just a few functions, such that I could be sure that if those functions worked as intended with regards to floating points, then it wouldn't affect the privacy, or then the privacy would floating points wouldn't violate differential privacy anywhere in my implementation. So in that way, I could focus it only on a few lines of code. And another thing I was considering was how much to expose to the end user, because there are some parameters for tuning the data structure that I won't get into now, but how I ended up implementing this was having one constructor for a measurement that takes in all possible parameters needed. And then I made sure that no matter what input was given to this constructor, it would always satisfy the privacy guarantees. Then the other constructors using default values, which most people would end up using, could simply call this one constructor. So both of these design decisions, the floating point one and the level of details, have one thing in common, that I wanted to centralize the centralize the privacy intensive code as much as possible, so that I know if those crucial parts of the implementation satisfy DP, then the rest of the implementation will satisfy DP. So this makes it a bit easier to go from theory and pseudocode to the actual implementation to have this kind of structure. For the FFI layers and Python bindings, I don't have much to say. Michael was great at helping with this, and he implemented everything for the layer and the bindings. So my role in this part of the project was simply to be a code reviewer, which was great because I don't myself have any experience with working with these layers and bindings. Now we are getting to the privacy proof, I'm sure that this will be the proofs will be discussed more tomorrow, but I'll just say to, now that the guidelines was sort of produced at the same time as the fellows program was running this year by the three interns credited here on the right. And very briefly, then what the crucial parts of the proofs is that you of course have this mathematical proof that the privacy relation you have implemented holds, and then you have some accompanying Python style pseudocode. And this is the current state of my project, because I deliberately chose not to focus on the proof during the program as these rules were still under development. So that will be the next step before I can actually, or my contribution can actually be incorporated into the main branch of the OpenDP library. So finishing off with some reflections, as I said, thinking back on what I got out of the OpenDP Fellows Program, the main thing I can say is, of course, that I have an not complete, but almost complete open source implementation now of my work, doing my PhDs, of my work related to my PhD studies, which was a great opportunity to be able to spend some time on actually making sure that this probably handles all the practical challenges there are when implementing these algorithms. And it's more than just a prototype. So that was a great opportunity to be able to make this implementation. And as I also stated in the beginning, one of the motivations for applying for the fellow program was to be part of this community. And I've also really enjoyed being part of this community. And I attended a lot of interesting talks and also heard about the other interesting projects going on as part of this larger OpenDP project. Then of course I would like to comment on how it has been like to work with a framework and a library that is still under development. There will, in such a case, there will of course always be some pros and cons. So starting with the negative, it can be a bit difficult at times since some of the processes are still under development. Now they are much further than when the program started. And also one of the pros related to the exact same thing is that I was actually able to have some kind of influence in how some of these processes works so that people can contribute. So it was great to be able to contribute in that way as well. As a final reflection for myself is whether I consider making any potential future contribution. That is really ultimate evaluation of how I would say this fellow program works. And for that, I would say that if I have a similar, or if I during my PhD study have a similar situation where I have an algorithm which could benefit from being part of the OpenDP library, then I now know much more about the how I would actually do this. Some of the early steps that I pointed out before could be skipped entirely because I have a greater understanding of how the library works already. So it's definitely something I will consider if I find an appropriate algorithm for me to implement, of course. Yes, and that was the end of my presentation. See, we have 5 minutes left. So yeah, if there's any questions, and I will also hang around a bit longer. Otherwise, you are also welcome to email as me as the slides is.
There's an open question. Thank you for that. There's an open question from Daniel Alebi. I'm not sure. How did you implement the hash functions? Is it deterministic?
The hash functions right now are so I sample hash functions and then they are deterministic after being sampled. So the hash functions is based on how's it called, simple multiply shift, multiply add shift.
Is it okay if I share a link?
Yeah, sure.
Right.
Yeah, I'm just reading through the
I think that's the only question at this time for Christian. But we do have a kind of an open comment section for any general questions.
So I see the previous question to Victoria was answered, but Ilya Mironov had a follow-up question. Do you want to talk about that, or that's a different topic?
Looks like Julian has a question. I'm going
to
try and.
Yeah, I wanted to ask a really practical question. The problem you described at the beginning is one that we're all terribly familiar with: how to deal with sparse histograms. How successful is this? Concentrated differential privacy, zero concentrated, in actually doing that, in reproducing them with reasonably useful for such histograms.
So that is a lot of the things I have skipped in this presentation. We came up with this data structure short background is we wanted to make sure that we of course don't use too much memory, and we have relatively fast access and low error, and we focused mostly on the error of point queries, where we get if we only have a single point query, we get an error that is similar to the Laplace distribution, and then by a factor, then the error is a factor of around 5 to 10 higher, because we have to do some tricks to actually reduce our space. It's difficult to go into too much details now in just a few moments.
Of course.
I would like elaborate more.
And I suppose your work isn't written up yet, is it?
It is. There's just an updated version of the paper that I will have to.
All right, perhaps you could post that in the chat.
Yes, I'll do that. Maybe I can share them.
This implementation is pretty far along. You can, from Python, construct these histograms in Aquarium, which is pretty neat. They're not in the current library release though, because we've been waffling about some redesigns on some of the FFI pieces.
Okay, so we're at 3:00. If you have any other questions, feel free to email us or ask on GitHub. You know how to find us. We're not hard to find, info@opendp.org. So with that, the wonderful presentations from Christian and Victoria as contributors conclude our day one of the community meeting. So we look forward to seeing you again tomorrow. Have a good rest of the day. Have a good night, everyone. Right.
Good night.